push buttons do not work without pull-up or pull-down resistors. We've done a couple of tutorials on that topic. But here's a crazy thought. What about buttons without buttons? This AddOhms episode is a capacitive touch tutorial with the help of this CapTIvate development kit from TI. Before we get touchy-feely with this box, first we need to go over some capacitive sensing basics. If you're familiar with CapTouch and just want to know about TI's CapTIvate kit, jump to the timecode on screen now. For everyone else, first we need to discuss my favorite component, the capacitor. A capacitor is two conductive electrode plates separated by a non-conductive dielectric. An electric field forms between the plates. Different dielectric materials change how much charge can be stored in that field. As an example, common ceramic capacitors use a material called barium titanate. Even air can be a dielectric, which means capacitors can be found in unexpected places. Anything with that structure has some amount of capacitance. Okay, how about an example of something that is a capacitor that isn't a capacitor? This is a two-sided circuit board. It has copper on each side, which is conductive, and a fiberglass core, which is the dielectric. Even this structure can store some amount of capacitance. To find out how much, we look at the surface area of the electrode plates, the distance between them, along with the dielectric's relative permittivity. This equation defines the amount of capacitance for that basic structure. Changing the separation distance of the electrode plates is one way to change the capacitance. You'll see why that matters in a few minutes. First, we need to talk about how to measure capacitance in a circuit, starting with how capacitors work. When you apply voltage to a capacitor, it starts to charge up to that voltage. This happens very fast unless you add a resistor to slow it down. Together, these create an RC charging circuit. The time to charge the capacitor depends on both the resistance and capacitance. So, by changing the capacitance of C, the time to charge also changes. With capacitive touch, we're less interested in the exact capacitance value and instead interested in the change in capacitance. The sensor pad is our capacitor in this circuit. When something conductive, like a finger, gets close to it, the capacitance changes. Here's an example of how to measure the capacitance change with a microcontroller. Digital pins have a threshold voltage that decides if a signal is high or low, so we can monitor an input pin while the output pin turns on a signal. Then it's just a matter of measuring how long it takes for the voltage to cross that threshold. If the charge time changes, we know something is coming close to or in contact with the capacitive sense pad. In this example, I showed you using two pins, but you could get away with using one pin, where you just switch the pin between input and output. A more reliable method is to use a dedicated touch controller. The MSP430 chip in this kit comes with one of those controllers built in. There are two techniques for sensing this change. They are self-capacitance and mutual capacitance. The cool thing is, this TI kit comes with examples of both. First up is self-capacitance. The sensing capacitor is a single copper pad surrounded by ground with a propagating electric field. This setup is very similar to the example we used earlier to explain how to measure capacitance. The 360-degree propagation is a good and bad thing. It is good because you can touch either side of the PCB. The downside is that means there are a larger field per button, which limits how many you can put next to each other. If we could reduce this field, we can pack in more buttons, which brings us to mutual capacitance. Mutual capacitive sense uses two electrodes to create a single touch point. Two electrodes means two pins. One pin generates a signal while the other pin senses it, creating a tight electric field between the two pads. When a finger enters the electric field, it actually reduces it, resulting in a slightly smaller capacitance. The pattern around these pads is called a guard band. It can either be a ground shield to help isolate the buttons, or it can be activated to detect when an entire hand is touching the panel. These pads can be interdigitated, which is a fancy way to say interlocking. So even though there are two pads, they can be placed together tightly. I just said slightly smaller capacitance. The crazy thing is that the change is like 1 picofarad, compared to self-capacitance where it's 10 picofarads. The smaller value can mean a noisier measurement, so care needs to be taken with the design. Summarizing the difference between the two types, let's compare PCB layout, pin count, pad count, proximity detection, and matrix. In my opinion, layout is a wash. Both have electrodes and ground. You can use more traces with mutual, but you get strong guard bands when compared to self. Self-capacitance uses fewer pins since it is one per pad, but mutual has a potential advantage, which I'll hit on in just a second. You might think that since twice the pins means twice the pads, that it'll take up twice the space. But as I showed earlier, interdigitated pads make it a wash since they really don't take up much space. Proximity detection is only available with self-capacitance. This is how you tell when a hand is getting close to the panel. By the way, you can combine self and mutual into the same panel or design, like this one. Like their physical counterparts, you can reduce pin counts using a matrix. Either technique can be used, however, the advantage goes to mutual cap because it can do simultaneous or multiple touches at once. Just like all things in engineering, which one is best completely depends on your application. So, now that this brief introduction is over, let's dig into TI's CapTIvate kit. Inside the box is a bunch of boards. By the way, lift up the packing material, there's more underneath. The kit includes three CapTouch boards. The first one is for gestures, this one is mostly for mutual capacitance, and this one is self-capacitance. The isolation board is useful for when debugging with a battery-powered project. Additionally, you get a programming board which plugs into the MSP430 FR2633 development board. That's easy to say. The FR2633 has 15K of program FRAM, 512 bytes of user FRAM, 4K of RAM, and supports up to 16 self or 64 mutual capacitive buttons. By the way, if you're not familiar with FRAM, it's like flash memory, but with much faster writes. TI has a bunch of information on it. Lastly, as an MSP430, it is a low power powerhouse. Did I really write that? Anyway, for software, you need to download two things, the CapTIvate Design Center and Code Composer Studio. Design Center configures the microcontroller based on the touch controls your panel uses. Tell it if the control is implemented as self or mutual, and Design Center auto-configures which pins to use. This timing table is really awesome. It shows that this particular design only needs 5 cycles to scan. Fewer cycles means more time to sleep between scans, which results in even more power savings. Once this configuration is done, Design Center exports a project for use in Code Composer Studio. From there, you can modify the code and upload it to the board. And unlike some platforms, this programmer offers full debug capability. You might notice I didn't go step by step through the setup, and the reason is that TI's documentation is a really good guide. The lab exercises work with no problem, and it got me going right out of the box. Kind of. Overall, it's a nice kit, but I did have a few issues. On OS X, Design Center didn't find my board even though it enumerated, so I ended up using a Windows virtual machine. But even then, Design Center would randomly lose communication when using the live sensors to monitor the pads. So maybe I have a hardware issue, but I ran out of time, so I couldn't actually debug it much further. I will give TI a big compliment on Code Composer Studio. Usually when I get these boards from other companies, they also depend on an Eclipse-based environment, but I have a lot of trouble with setting that up. With Code Composer, it literally was download, install, and I could program the board on the first try. I really appreciate that their IDE works out of the box. In review, Capacitive Touch is a modern way to add interactivity without a physical button. The MSP430 is a great platform for touch applications, especially when running on battery. The CapTIvate kit is a great way to evaluate how different designs will work in your project or product. Despite the few issues I had, I still see value in the kit. So, let me turn this around on you. What would you use capacitive touch buttons for? Let me know over on Element 14. There you'll find feedback as well as links related to this episode. Thank you for watching, and I really hope you get in touch. Get it? Because the touching?